My name is Tinesh. I work at the Humsafar Trust as the advocacy manager. And the Humsafar Trust is the oldest LGBTQ organization in India, working from last 25 years.
Hi, my name is Megha Sheth, and I am the mental health professional. I'm a counselist here at Humsafar Trust. And I have done MBA and MA in counseling psychology.
As I mentioned, the Humsafar Trust is India's first and the oldest LGBTQ organization founded by Mr. Ashok Ravi, who is a reputed journalist in India, and he is one of the first out gay men in India, who came out in 1978 in front of me and said, "Hey, I'm here and I'm a homosexual," and from there it started. So Humsafar Trust actually started from the magazine called Bombay Dost. So Bombay Dost is also India's first registered LGBTQ magazine. And the work of Bombay Dost and the magazine still continue till date. And the Bombay Dost is actually from where the work started. But while working with the magazine, the team of Bombay Dost realized, one of them was Ashok Rao Kavi, they realized that the magazine is not just enough. We need a strong support system or a strong system to raise voices of LGBTQ members, because they were getting letters from across India saying, "I also like you, I'm married man, I have feelings for other men, what should I do?" And then they started getting lots of phone call, and that's where they realized. And in 1994, the Humsafar Trust was born. And currently, the Humsafar Trust has four verticals. The first is the health, where we work with the Ministry of Health and State AIDS Control Society, where we actually implement the HIV intervention program on the field, and we reach out to almost 8,000 who have a sex with men, transgender, and hijra in Mumbai. One of the core work area is we do provide medical services to the communities, and it is a free of cost service. So we have a 3 clinic across the city, and we can walk in those clinics and get tested for HIV, regular medical checkup done. They can also get a recently inaugurated our HIV treatment center, where you get ART medication for free. I have a government tie-up with that. And we have a Megha, who is a mental health counselor. If you're facing any issues with your sexuality or with any mental health issues, so you can consult Megha over the phone or to the face-to-face counseling. So that is our health unit. Our second vertical is advocacy. So advocacy is more about talking about policy change, at the various levels. So we conduct sensitization workshops with different forums in schools, colleges, university, with law enforcement authority, importantly, because then we had this Canonical Law Section 377, which actually criminalizes homosexual activity. So because of that, many community members faced harassment, blackmail. So one of our challenge was Section 377, and we managed to struggle with one of the Supreme Court. Another work of advocacy is to talk to media. So media portrayed plays an important role when it comes to LGBTQ representation. So we do conduct with sensitization workshop with media. We have a manual called Sanchar. So Sanchar is the reporting manual for the media professional. So the manual has lots of information about community and the how to report on community issues. So in those terms, media. Then we have a different initiative. Maybe we can elaborate on the initiative, elaborate on this initiative. Then the third vertical is the capacity building unit, because we realize working with the communities that we also have a limited resources, and we believe building the capacities of the community on grounds. We have a network called Integrated Network for Sexual Minorities, which is India's largest sexual minorities network, and which has almost 120 registered organizations working with us. So we do conduct periodic training for them. We do conduct sensitization advocacy event with our partners. So that is capacity capacity building, and the last one is the research, which is the most important, because if we want to talk about policy change, we need some data or to research to reach out to policymaker, and that's where our research unit complement the other verticals of Humsafar. But our most of the research revolves around HIV and STI among men who have a sex with men and transgender and hijra population. But we do have advocacy and the human rights studies which we have done in the past. So those are the four verticals. We also have some initiative which are important for us, specifically for LGBTQ youth, which is Yaria, Umang and Sanjeevani. So that is a brief background about the Humsafar Trust.
So Umang is an initiative by Humsafar, and it is for those assigned female at birth. So we have lesbian, bisexual women and trans masculine persons. So that is basically, so historically the problem has always been that women don't have spaces as men do, especially in places like India, which are very conservative. So you don't see people, you don't see the way men loiter, you don't see women loitering. So we might have cruising spots for men, but we don't have cruising spots for women. So because of that, and also because of safety issues, we needed a support group. We needed a safe space for women to actually just be themselves and be a part of the community. And that is where Umang Initiative came into being. So say, for example, when we look at the transgender umbrella, trans women, because we have the Hijra community, trans women have always been more visible than, say, trans men. So what happens is that even when you go to places like where people know that trans women, transgender women are there, it comes as a surprise for them to, oh, even women, those who are assigned female at birth, can become men. So it's not something that's out there. So if you look at the percentage of trans women to trans men, you'll find that there are a lot less trans men out there than compared to trans women. And when it comes to LGBTQ, like I said, that there's not enough space for them. Also, there is this whole thing about getting married. So even those who identify as lesbian or bisexual women, they are married off. They are said that, oh, once you get married, then everything is going to be okay. So that is another issue that a problem that we face.
When it comes to a larger society, so we can see the two totally different two stands. The one chunk is, they are coming from very religious background and they have their own beliefs and myths around, homosexuality and LGBTQ identities. But in these days, I think the scenario is quite changing and the society is coming forward to accept the identities that are especially towards transgender and hijra, because mythologically also we have references in Indian culture where the transgenders are mentioned, hijra cultures are mentioned. But when it comes to LGBT as a whole spectrum, society is coming forward to accept them as an individual, specifically after the landmark Supreme Court judgment, which happened on 6 September 2018 last year. So there are many companies and the institution, college, who are coming forward and, welcoming the community at their workplace we also trying to mainstreaming and use this opportunity to mainstream LGBTQ community in the society. So hijra is basically, it's a cultural identity. It's a group of a transgender who do not get easily accepted in our society. That's why they have created their own support system, their own, they have developed their own languages, rules and regulations. So it's a cultural community where, we get the references of the Hijra Gharana since the British was there. And even before that, they hold the very, higher authority or the power in those days. But specifically, they were criminalized when British came to India. So they introduced this act called Criminal Tribe Act. And when British came to India, they saw, or they noticed rather, that the Indian society is divided into the various pieces, and that's where they try to you know, introduced this Criminal Tribe Act, and that's where they specifically targeted the Hijra population, because they saw some men, you know, wearing clothes, going on dancing on the streets, you know, begging on the streets, and they really cannot control that. Maybe they cannot have a hold on that population. So that's why they introduced, and they were criminalized under. So whoever they saw on the street, maybe begging, dancing, they put them behind the bar, and there was some, a fine as well. So that was the moment, since the movement was started, the transgender movement. But then after India got its independence, the Criminal Tribe Act was changed, and that there was certain section of that act which was removed, where basically the Hijra identity were targeted. And then from there, we can see, you know, we have references in our mythology, saying Ramayana, Mahabharata. So they hold some, religious powers as well. And that's where they started getting recognition in the society when it comes to a religion. So yeah, that's there. Actually, the fight started in, way back in 1994. And we had this colonial law when British came to India, they came with certain laws and became a part of the Indian culture and the constitution, rather, where in 1860, when the constitution was drafted, so the British came to India with their thought, and that's where they introduced Section 377, which says whoever voluntarily has a carnal intercourse against the order of nature. So they use the word against the order of nature with any man, women, and with any animal shall be punishable under Section 377. What does that mean? Basically, it says if you have any kind of sexual activity which will not procreate, so that will be criminalized under Section 377. So basically, particularly the homosexual community was targeted under Section 377, though the law was also applicable to heterosexual community, because even if a husband wife practicing anal sex or any kind of sexual activity which does not lead to a procreation shall be punishable, or may be applicable to a heterosexual couple as well. But that was the Section 377 was specifically targeted by by the police officer to target homosexual community, and the decriminalization of Section 377 started in 1994, where there was one organization called AIDS Virodhi Bhedbhav Andolan, AVBP. They filed an actual case in Delhi High Court saying Section 377 is there. So by that time, Indian government had introduced a HIV prevention project for homosexual community, and that was the one section due to which they really cannot talk about having safe sex practices amongst homosexual men or men who have a sex with men. And that's it started. And then the case did not get followed by, the particular organization, and the case dropped out from the Delhi High Court. But again, there was another organization called NAS Foundation India. So NAS Foundation again filed a case in 2001 mentioning that was again this with the similar reason, saying it creates a barrier to distribute condoms on the field and to talk about safe sex practices among homosexuals. They also filed a petition saying the Section 377 actually take away the basic human rights of as an Indian citizen, I have some basic constitutional rights. So they target that as well. So that comes to Article 15 or Article 15, which says freedom of expression. So it take away the freedom of expression. So they mentioned the various points in the petition, but it was 18 years of struggle where during those 18 years, in 2009. So Delhi High Court decriminalized Section 377, mentioning that we agree, and the basic human rights should be given to all the all the human individuals. So, but again, when 2009 judgment came in, there were few religious groups who filed a petition in Supreme Court challenging the Delhi High Court judgment, saying this is against our society, our homosexuality is unnatural. They gave various reasons. So there were a quite number of religious group who came together from the community, and they filed a case in Supreme Court. And again in 2013, Supreme Court of India again decriminalized or overturned the Delhi High Court judgment, saying there was a fault or we accept the the challenges. We accept the fact that the homosexuality cannot be a part of the Indian culture. So they overturned the Delhi High Court judgment. But again, we fought the case, we filed a curative petition. As I mentioned, Humsafar Trust was one of the petitioners in the case. So we approached Supreme Court of India again, and we filed a curative petition. And luckily, the curative petition was accepted in Supreme Court. So the curative petition is the last stage, and it get accepted in very rare case. I would say in the Indian history, the Section 377 case was the third case which was accepted for the curative petition. And then there was an argument, there was an argument in Supreme Court, and last year in 2018, Indian Supreme Court gave a judgment saying we accept the fact that homosexual or the LGBT community have faced lots of stigma, discrimination in the society, and now we decriminalize Section 377. So I think it was a 18 years journey, and that was a quite a roller coaster ride for us, because then we approached Delhi High Court judgment, then again we gone to Supreme Court, then again back forth to the High Court, then again to Supreme Court. So I think that was a kind of, quite a challenging experience. But now we are happy that Section 377 is no more there with, in the IPC of Indian Penal Code of India.
So I think as what I've seen as a mental health professional is that one thing I think I didn't talk about it is that we, especially when it comes to India, is that India is a very heteronormative society. So what that means is that we look at everything through heterosexual lenses, basically. We look at everything through and marriage is a huge deal in India. So a lot of people suffer, but people also want to get married. So what tends to happen is that, if I want to get married, I can only get married to a, if I'm a woman, I can only get married to a man. If I'm a man, I can only get married to a woman. So I think the one huge step that the government or everything together needs to take is civil unions or, same gender marriages. So that is one thing. The other thing that we need to look at is education, because if you look at the textbooks that we have even right now, or the entire educational system, we don't talk about LGBTQ. So it's only when we start talking about it, when we start mainstreaming it, when the government starts talking about it, starts taking things like allows, does not censor, does not censor LGBTQ content, is when we'll actually see it in mainstream and people will start, for lack of a better word, normalizing it. So that is something that needs to happen, and there has to be more research. People have to, now that we have struck down struck down 377, Section 377. So I think there needs to be more research that needs to take place, because we know that there's in the LGBT2+ community, we have very high suicide rates, and people who have higher rates of anxiety, depression, and things like that. So that is again one thing that we really need to start focusing on. Over to you, Tinesh.
Yeah, I think one of the things that we need to work on is right now is, though we got an legal acceptance last year, but we still don't have a social acceptance when it comes to a larger society. So I think one of the work area of Humsafar Trust is to initiate the conversation in the mainstream society of, around sex, gender, sexuality, because even if you, like Megha mentioned, sexuality or the sex, it's still a taboo in the Indian society. So I think we need to initiate that in conversation in every forum, even in the school, in the colleges, at every level, even in the ministries as well, because we have noticed that after Section 377 judgment, there have been a positive steps taken by, you know, Indian government, where we have a Mental Health Care Act, which talks about, you know, LGBT. They recognized LGBT community, and they also mentioned that, you know, LGBT, you know, commit suicide rates are quite high. Then on another, you know, bill or the law that which we have against people living with HIV, they also mentioned, you know, about the homosexual community or the LGBTQ community. So there are few, you know, steps taken by the government, but I think we need to have this conversation very strongly when it comes to policy changes.